Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
Are we? I was thinking about a few words that get tossed around. The idea is people say, I'm a follower of Jesus. Well, I look at a follower, and I look at a disciple, and I look at an apostle. And I think people tend to put up on a pedestal the individuals called apostles as a cream of the crop, as individuals that we could never aspire to be. And of course, that is absolutely true, because Jesus handpicked those apostles. But there are plenty of people who God has commissioned, and an apostle simply means a sent one. So anyone that's sent, anyone that's commissioned to go somewhere and do something for the cause of Christ, really, in that sense, is an apostle. But a disciple is a follower in learning. All apostles were disciples, but not all disciples were apostles. Does that make sense? Okay, now, all disciples are followers, but not all followers are disciples. A follower is one who comes, goes, or moves after another. But that doesn't tell you the reason. You know, many people follow Jesus for what they could get out of him. A lot of people are followers of Jesus because they're Klingons. Matter of fact, some, you know what they call some in the animal world, or maybe in the aquarium? You know what they would call a Klingon? A leech. A leech. And what is a leech? Somebody that just sucks the lifeblood out of another living entity. And that's what, there's a lot of followers in Christianity today. A lot of people just going along with the crowd. And they really contribute not a whole lot to the cause for Christ. They're just following along. In some cases, they're nothing more than leeches. They suck out the lifeblood, the energies, out of those that are looking to actually serve God. Those that are really disciples. Notice, Jesus wasn't looking for someone to be a follower. He wasn't even asking for somebody to be an apostle, because he's the one that sends them. But he wants people to be disciples. In other words, he wants followers in learning. That's what a disciple is. But then he gives the qualifications for it. And as I said, we need to ask ourselves, am I a disciple? Do I want to be a disciple? We had mentioned earlier, I forget who we were making the reference to there, but you know, many people are just content to be saved, and that's it. That's it. They came to Christ for they're not, you can't even call them followers, because they don't even want to follow. They came and they made a profession of faith, and now you can't find them, as Brother Steve Kogel would say, you can't find them with the FBI or the CIA or the ATM, or I just list the whole stinking bunch of them. In other words, you can't find with a magnifying glass and so on and so forth. But why is that? Because the reason they came was not because they really wanted Jesus. They wanted something for themselves. And in most instances, all they really wanted was to get out of hell. They didn't want to change anything in their life. They weren't going to do anything differently in their life. They just wanted to have, could you give me my card? So that when I die, I can present it at the gates, at the pearly gates, and they'll let me in because I said a prayer once upon a time. Jesus desires saved people to be disciples. He wants us to follow, but he wants us to learn. And something that I've kind of gained over the years, that if you study to show thyself approved unto God. If you'll study the Word of God, you know what you'll do? You'll learn. And you know what? If you learn some things, you might even be inclined to apply some things in your life. And of course, you're deceiving your own self. James said that if you don't be a doer of the word, then you're just deceiving yourself. You're not spiritual. You haven't really learned anything. You haven't gained wisdom and understanding. You've gained a little bit of knowledge. And you know what I've found? That giving some individuals a little bit of knowledge makes them dangerous. Makes them dangerous. Doesn't make them profitable, just dangerous. But here in our text here, I want to speak to some folks tonight, obviously you, and anyone that would listen. Do you really want to be a disciple? Do you want to follow him? Do you want to learn about him? Do you want to apply these principles to your life? Do you want to be different? I would have to say that Jesus is looking for some people to just be disciples. You let him worry about sending you somewhere. In the meantime, you just be willing to follow him and learn about him. Isn't that what Jesus said? He said, come unto me, Matthew 11:20. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and what? Learn of me. Learn of me. Because why? When we learn of him, we'll desire him. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. When we learn about him, when we learn how he operates, we'll change. We have to change. But notice what it says there in verse number 28. For which of you, intending to build a tower, sitteth not down first and counteth the cost? Counting the cost. You know, that really determines for us whether or not we'll ever be disciples. Are you willing to pay the price? Because as we saw in our text here, Jesus gives three different reasons or three different criteria by which we determine whether or not we are disciples or merely followers, if we're even followers. But hopefully we'll go beyond just following, just tagging along for the ride. Hopefully we desire something a little more in depth than just tagging along. So with that said, and with that in mind, about counting the cost, number one, Jesus said here in verse number 26, he spoke of relationships, and he said we must, number one, abhor. Number one, abhor. A-B-H-O-R. There's some things we need to hate. And he says specifically what it is. Now, see, we would think that in order to be a disciple, he would say, you must hate sin. No, you ought to hate sin in order to get saved. That's already concluded. That's why you got saved. Listen to me. That's why you got saved. You hated sin. You hated the effect it was having on your life. And you wanted something different. You hated sin and you loved God and you loved the chance of being saved. That's why that's a foregone conclusion. We're talking about being a disciple now. So it's not about hating sin. He says here, he is making this relationship thing, which I'll tell you, this precludes many people from being disciples right here. If any man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and don't separate this, because he says, and his own life also. That's right. So it's not like, you know, people would say, well, do I have to hate my family? Forget about your family. You need to hate you. Amen. But the idea is the relationship. Jesus is speaking about natural affections versus devotedness to Christ. You don't have to hate your parents in order to be saved and love Jesus. But we're talking about when it comes time to follow, to be a follower and learning of Jesus, if you have to make a choice between mommy and daddy and brother and sister and wife or anybody or even yourself, If you win and Jesus loses, Jesus said, don't bother. Don't bother. You can't be my disciple. He says, even yourself. In Galatians 1 and verse number 10, Paul said, for do I now persuade men or God, or do I seek to please men? For if I yet pleased men, I should not be the servant of Christ. If family or self has control of your life, you cannot be a disciple. Why? Because it's going to cost you something. It's going to cost you something. And I've seen way too many times where, when it came right down to it, when people had to make a choice between family and God, they chose family. God isn't saying that you have to hate your family. You know, he doesn't go, pick or choose. No. He said, but if you desire to be a disciple, if you want to follow me, if you want to learn, if you want to involve yourselves in spiritual things, then you have to realize that those earthly relationships are going to pull you away from the spiritual relationships. They will. They will all the time. And count on it. Count on it. I've seen this too many times. I could write a book on the subject. If as soon as a person gets saved, count on it. When it comes time for them to start applying themselves and just being a regular church attender, guarantee the devil is going to cause the family to come visit you Sunday morning. And I've heard it so many times. People say, well, my brother came over. What could I do? What could you do? Come on, you can't be serious. You say, dear old brother, we go to church on Sunday morning. You're welcome to come along with us. Or, hey, here's the keys. Sit here and watch television. We'll be back in a couple hours. What could I do? You'll never be a disciple of Jesus. You won't. And so there are some things that we need to abhor. Secondly, let me say there's some things we need to accept. In verse number 27, it says, and whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. We've got to accept the cross. Now, the cross is something that should be borne and not worn. Now, I understand that people don a cross or a crucifix around their neck, and somehow, I don't know, they think it's either a lucky charm or they, you know, see, I have this on. It actually infuriates me when I see some derelicts, and I do mean derelicts. You see them like the most hellish people in the world, and they have on a cross around their neck or little cross earrings or something like that. It infuriates me when I see that. Because who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? Do you think that negates? Think that negates your wicked behavior because you have a cross around your neck? And it's the cross that needs to be taken up and not a cause. Christianity is just loaded with one cause after another. No, it's about taking up a cross, not taking up a cause. He said that we need to deny ourselves. You know, folks, being a disciple is going to cost us something. Notice he does not say take up the cross, because we took up the cross when we got saved. The cross is Jesus' cross. It says take up his cross. Take up his cross. In Philippians 2, verse 7 and 8, the Bible said, but made himself, speaking of Jesus, of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. In John 10, verse 17, the Bible said, "Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, that I might take it again. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, I have power to take it again." The cross stands for a life that is voluntarily surrendered to the will of God. Take up his cross. The cross speaks of a willful obedience to the wishes of God. That's what his cross, your cross, my cross is. That's what Jesus did. He took up his cross. He took up an implement to go to the cross, but he was willing to subject himself to the will of someone else, namely the Father. Romans 12:1, "I beseech you therefore by the mercies of God that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service." Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15:31, "I die daily." Not being nailed to a cross. He's just submitting himself. He said, "I'm going to allow my flesh and its want to's to die so that I can subject myself to the will of the one in whom I'm serving." Romans 8 and verse 13, "For if we live after the flesh, we shall die. But if we through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, we shall live." And since God, Jesus Christ, John 10:10, he came so that we might have what? Life. He wants us to live. Galatians 2:20, "I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless," what? "I live. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." The song says, "It will be worth it all." And if we'll die to our wishes now and accept what God has for us, bear our cross, whatever it is that he sends our way, whatever it is, Lord, I'll do it. In Hebrews 12:2, the Bible said, "Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God." Folks, we can look beyond all of the heartaches, all of the trials, all the troubles we go through in this life for what lies ahead down the road. If you're going to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, you're going to have to mortify your flesh. You're going to have to take up your cross. You're going to have to die daily. You have to realize it's not about you. It's not about me. We're going to have to accept that. We need to abhor some things. Earthly relationships. Jesus, he is to have the preeminence in all things. Amen. He comes first. There's no choosing. There's no picking and choosing. It doesn't matter who the family relative is. It doesn't matter if it's a mother, a father, an aunt, an uncle, a child, a cousin. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if it's your boss. It doesn't matter if it's your next door neighbor. It doesn't matter. We serve the Lord God. Amen. He comes first. That's all. It's not. You don't have to spit in the face of the people that we love, but we just say no. God comes first. If you can't make that same, you can't be Jesus' disciple. You might be a follower, but you won't be a disciple. But let me also give you this. And I didn't make this up. This isn't some Baptist church prerequisite to being a disciple. Jesus said this. Jesus said this to a multitude that was following him. As I said earlier, can you imagine doing such a thing? I guarantee you, it must have really miffed the disciples. You know, the apostles following Jesus. When he made this statement, all of these people following him and everything, and all of a sudden Jesus goes off on this tangent. They must have said to him, "What are you doing? Look at the following we got here. You could go and say something stupid like that." Jesus said, "Yeah, we're going to separate the followers from the disciples." So he just asked him, "You know, you want to be a disciple?" He said, "There are some things that you're going to have to abhor." And notice it wasn't something that we might dislike. It was something that we hold near and dear to us. He said, "When it, you know, you're going to have to choose. You're going to love the Lord God with your whole heart, your whole mind, your whole soul, your whole being. We're supposed to love God that way. People need to see that in us.
Right. Amen.
It's not a matter of that we don't care for our families. We do. We love them dearly. We want to see them saved. But they have to know that we love God. We have to abhor some things. We need to accept some things. And then thirdly, we need to abandon some things. In verse number 33, it says, "So likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath." Now, that doesn't mean many people have gone out and they say, well, you know, you have to sell all your possessions. You have to live. You have to be a pauper. No, it doesn't say that. What it says is you have got to be willing to forsake it all. Everything you have. What if God were to reach out and say, "I want that"? Would you give it up? What is it that you will hold back from God? Ananias and Sapphira held back. Oh, when they saw what was going down, and when they saw how Barnabas had been praised for having sold a piece of property and gave it all to the church, and everyone was happy with him and applauded him and everything. They said, "Hey, we ought to get in on that. Well, let's sell something. Let's give it. Let's show them how much we love God." I believe they love God. I believe they wanted to be helpful to the church. I believe they did. I don't think that they just came in from the outside and said, let's make a name for ourselves. But see, they weren't willing to forsake it all. They wanted to hold back a little. In Acts 5, verse 1, it says, "But a certain man named Ananias with Sapphira, his wife, sold a possession and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it, and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet." We don't even know what part it was. Was it the greater part? Was it the lesser part? We don't know. But see, it didn't matter. They still kept back some. Holding out on God. Holding out on God. See, we're not saying you can't be saved and be this way. You can. A lot of saved people this way. But do you want to be a disciple? If you're a disciple, you've got to be willing to forsake it all. But Peter said, "Ananias, why hath Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land?" Again, we don't know how much of a part it was. Maybe he only kept back 5%. We don't know. See, we read that and we think to ourselves, he probably kept 90%. Maybe he didn't. Let's give him the benefit of the doubt. He was part of the church. He probably said, "Well, you know, we're doing a good thing here, dear. You know, let's give 80% and we'll just keep 20. Cost him. "Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God." See, the issue was not that he kept back anything. He didn't have to do that. He didn't have to sell anything. He didn't have to give anything. But what he did and what he let people believe that he was doing were two different things. Yeah. That's why Jesus said in Matthew 19, if you turn over there, Matthew 19, verse 23 to 28, then said Jesus unto his disciples, "Verily I say unto you, that a rich man shall hardly enter into the kingdom of heaven. And again I say unto you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God." When his disciples heard it, they were exceedingly amazed, saying, "Who then can be saved?" But Jesus beheld them and said unto them, "With men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible." Then answered Peter and said unto him, "Behold, we have forsaken all and followed thee. What shall we have therefore?" Lest you think that somehow to give it all for the cause of Christ is somehow going to leave you less than what you deserve. Notice what he said. He said, "Verily I say unto you, that ye which have followed me in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory, ye also shall sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel." we're never going to outgive God. He is not unfaithful to forget our labors of love. He sees everything that we do. And believe me, we will be rewarded one day for it. But are you willing to abandon what you have? You know, the apostles were Jesus handpicked. You know, the Bible speaks, in the Gospel of John, speaks of how Jesus knew what was in men. He knew that. So think about it. How long do you think it took Jesus to select his apostles? Do you ever give that a thought? Jesus walking along the seashore of Galilee there. Do you think he asked 2,387 men? And he finally was able to gather up this ragtag bunch of 12? No, he knew what was in man. And as he walked along, he spoke to this one. And he already knew the crowd he was picking. He already knew that they were ready, willing, and able to forsake all. I mean, was it just lucky guessing on his part? Do you think he played eeny, meeny, miny, moe? No, he knew, and he knows us. He knows us. He knows why we do what we do and why we don't do what we ought to do. In Matthew chapter 4, verse 18, Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brethren, Simon called Peter and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And he saith unto them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And they straightway left their nets and followed him. Do you think he just had this magnetic personality? Or maybe Jesus just picked the right people to do his bidding. You know why some people aren't selected to do certain things for God? Because God knows they won't do it. You know why God calls certain people to go to foreign lands and not others? Because he knows who'll go and who won't. Why would he waste his time calling someone that he knows isn't going to go? And going on from thence, he saw other two brethren. He just ran into the right people, right? James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in a ship with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets. And he called them. And they immediately left the ship and their father and followed him. Why didn't Zebedee go? Couldn't Zebedee have said, ooh, 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 take me too, Lord? No. No, he didn't call him. He called James and John. Others could have got in on it. Whether they were coming or going, they were willing to forsake all. Are you a disciple of Christ tonight? Are you a student of the book? Do you care to be? Then you need to ask yourself this question: am I willing to pay the price?
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, fundamental, King James Bible-believing church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to attend any of our Bible-centered services. Our service times are as follows: Sunday school for all ages at 9:30 a.m. Sunday worship services at 10:30 a.m. and again at 6 p.m. And our midweek prayer meeting and Bible study, Wednesday at 7 p.m.